In the manuscript, this is followed, after a space, by the single line, Young Aesop fabling by the coracle Toei. It seems fairly certain that these eight stanzas were completed before the broadcast, for, as you have heard, Dylan Thomas repeated in his introduction the lines, Light and his tears glide down together, hand in hand, together with the line, Bushes and owls blow out like a spark. It is even possible that the eight stanzas were written before any of the three poems, for they include images and similes that we also find in modified forms in the three poems. For instance, Young Aesop fabling by the coracle Toei becomes, in Over Sir John's Hill, I, young Aesop, fabling to the near night by the dingle of eels. Again, the long fox-like fire prowls flaming among the cockerels becomes, in in-country sleep, among the cocks like fire the red fox burning. The small brown friars, as he describes the moles, becomes, in the white giant's thigh, the scurrying furred small friars squeal in the douse of day. Moreover, I have been told that during the winter of 1948, while he was living near Whitney, Dylan Thomas read to a couple of friends about 100 lines of a poem entitled In Country Heaven. This version is not known to survive, but there do exist 5 worksheets. The first of these contains 3.5 stanzas with a few variant phrases, such as,
The shooting star hawk halted blind in a cloud over the kind green shires,
over the spring green shires.
The second worksheet runs,
The shooting star hawk statued blind in a cloud over the negro shires.
In the 8 stanza version, this becomes,
His shooting star hawk locked blind in a lame cloud over the blackamoor shires.
Some of the worksheets overlap in places, with lines written on the back of one sheet that carry on from a second sheet. But it is possible to trace roughly the development of the poem forwards from the 8 stanza version.
Always when he, in country heaven, whom my heart hears, crosses the breast of the praising east and kneels, humble in all his planets, and weeps on the abasing hill,
the abasing mount, peak, crest,
and weeps on the abasing crest, then in the last place and pride of beasts and birds,
the last ward and good,
then in the last ward and joy of beasts and birds, and the canonized valley where the dewfall stars sing grazing still,
where all sings that was made and is dead,
where all sings that was made and is dead. And the angels whir like pheasants through aisles of leaves,
through naves of leaves.
At this stage, we have reached what is apparently the final form of the first 2 stanzas, as written in a pencil draft on the back of a letter dated 7th of December 1950.
Always when he, in country heaven, whom my heart hears, crosses the breast of the praising east and kneels, humble in all his planets, and weeps on the abasing crest. Then in the last ward and joy of beasts and birds, and the canonized valley where all sings that was made and is dead, and the angels whir like pheasants through naves of leaves.
The stanzas that follow were considerably revised and reached their final draft in a notebook dated October 1951. In the 8 stanza version, they begin,
Light and his tears glide down together,
fall down together, dew fall together.
Dew fall, you notice, is taken from the deleted line in the preceding stanza, where the dew fall stars sing grazing still. But dew fall is not yet finally selected.
Light and his tears glide down together, oh, hand in hand. From the country eyes, salt and sun, stars and snows, down the cheekbones and whinny downs into brindle browsing dark.
In December 1950, a more powerful image appears.
Light and his tears glide down together. Go down, my truth. From the raining suns in his face, over the eyes.
Over the bones.
Over the bones and piteous paths he cries his blood down the ragged,
the haggard
cliffs of his heart and the blowholes of his wounds into sea deep and silent dark. Bushes and owls blow out like candles, and the seraphic fields of shepherds fade with their cares.
The next stage seems to be this.
Light and his tears glide down together, oh, hand in hand. He cries his blood, and the Lord's sons melt down the cheekbones.
Melt through the sockets and ragged gutters of his face into salt dark.
And he cries his blood down the ragged gutters of his face, and the sons melt.
In the next stage, dewfall is finally chosen.
Light and his tears dewfall together, oh, hand in hand, from the eyes and the manifold sky.
Out of the pierced eyes and the cataract sky.
Out of the pierced eyes and the cataract sky, he cries his blood, and the suns dissolve and run down the ragged gutters of his face into the salt dark and black.
In a black cataract.
Salt, night, dark, blind.
Heaven is cataract.
Heaven is blind and black. Bushes and owls blow out like candles, and the seraphic fields of shepherds fade with their belled and knelling tribes.
Fade, belled and knelling, black and blind.
Fade with their belled and knelling kind.
Finally, in the notebook of October 1951, comes the fair copy of stanzas 1 to 3 and line 1 of stanza 4. Possibly other worksheets may yet be found with revisions of the remaining stanzas. Meanwhile, here are the first three stanzas in their final form.
Always when he, in country heaven, whom my heart hears, crosses the breast of the praising east and kneels humble in all his planets and weeps on the abasing crest, then in the last ward and joy of beasts and birds and the canonized valley, where all sings that was made and is dead, and the angels whir like pheasants through naves of leaves. Light and his tears dewfall together, oh, hand in hand, out of the pierced eyes and the cataract sky. He cries his blood, and the suns dissolve and run down the ragged gutters of his face. Heaven is blind and black.
Humphrey Searle recalled that, towards the end of his life, Dylan spoke to him about a poem which must have been in Country Heaven, though Humphrey Searle thought he spoke of the moon.
He told me he had two long poems in mind, one of which was about the shepherds on the moon, watching the earth after it had been destroyed in an atomic war. And I asked him when he hoped to be able to finish the poem, but he said he didn't think he could finish it, which was very sad, but I know he was feeling this time rather depressed about his work.